sweetness of emancipation, fullness of abundant life, echoes of redemption stirring wide. Let every generation come and worship the Lord as one. In love and adoration, lift your voice to the Holy Son.
Worship is our declaration. Unity is our embrace. Breaking down the
早上好，早安，真高兴今天你们能够来参加以勒教会的直播崇拜。诗人这么说，神啊，我心坚定，我心坚定，我要歌唱，我要颂赞，我的灵啊，你要醒过来，情和色啊，你们都要醒过来，我也要唤醒黎明。主啊，我要在万民中称谢你，在万族中歌颂你，因为你的慈爱伟大，高及诸天，你的信实上达云霄。神啊，愿你被尊崇，过于诸天，愿你的荣。
Good morning to you and greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to start worshiping this morning and we are going to sing a Chinese song first. So it will actually sing in Chinese. So if you don't speak Chinese, you can look at the Romanized letters on the PowerPoint over there. And then we will sing it one time in an English translation.
Once I was lost in
Jesus came down to bring me salvation, lifting me up from sorrow and shame. Now I belong to Him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity. Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. His precious blood He gave to this morning with "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus." Jesus Himself said that the road is narrow, the way is hard that leads to salvation, and few that are that find it. Jesus completely saved us at the cross, but the road to follow Him is very, very hard. Let's not fool ourselves into thinking that it's easy, and let's pray that the Lord would give us more determination to follow Him.
Turning back.
在希伯来书十一章里面，圣经告诉我们，亚伯拉罕在寄居之地，他可以回去，可是他没有回去，因为他等候的是那将来 的神的应许，要给他的一座城。我们做基督徒，有多少的人已经决定要跟随耶稣呢？当我们决定要跟随耶稣的时候，我们要回头呢，还是不回头？圣经上告诉我们说，若有人要跟从我，就要舍己，背起他的十字架来跟从我。弟兄姐妹，盼望我们真正都能够在神的面前下定决心说，我们要跟随他，跟随他到底。谢谢诗凯弟兄带领我们所唱的敬拜诗歌，请我们大家一同低头的祷告。我们的天父，谢谢你赐给我们生命和气息，今天早上唤醒我们来敬拜你。虽然你一直忠诚地热爱着我们，我们却不是如此。我们求你赦免我们在过去的年间常常在属灵的生命当中与你同行的事上，我们充满了冷漠迟钝，我们心也不专一，我们很遗憾浪费了很多的机会，没有把我们每天追求你放在我们的生命当中的优先，而这些的机会过去的时候以后也不再回来了。深愿我们今年的开始，你能够唤醒我们的灵，让我们能够重新评估我们的生活，而且能够立志，决心立志，要把你放在我们生命计划里面所做的一切的事上，让你成为我们的第一优先。随着总统就职典礼即将的来临，我们为1月21号政府和平的交替代祷，看到我们的国家和文化正在迅速的偏行几路，远远的离开你。我们为了你，始终会按照你公义的主权降下审判在这个国家，我们为此而悲叹，也为此而惧怕。正如先知哈巴谷所说，耶和华，我听见你的声音，惧怕你的作为。求你在这些年间复兴，在这些年间彰显，发怒的时候以怜悯为怀。我们不知道是否还会有一个普世复兴的机会，就算没有，我们也深愿你复兴你的儿女和你的教会，并帮助我们行事为人和基督的福音相配，好使我们无可指责，在这弯曲归妙的世代当中，做你没有瑕疵的儿女，在这个世代中我们发光，好像天上的光体一样，能把生命的道显扬出来。今天早上我们感谢你，让家湾姐妹继续在冠状病毒后的复原，也为林慧、许健和宁州的复原我们感恩。求你保护你的教会和我们的听众免受这个疾病的感染，我们求你让疫苗能够有效率的实施，来帮助我们缓解这个流行性的疾病。我们求你赐下智慧，指引你的教会什么时候可以重新打开教堂的大门，再次能够面对面的一起敬拜。同时主要在今年，我们求你向以勒教会显明你自己的恩典和慈爱，求你赐给我们一个合你心意的父母师，使我们可以装备好向我们的邻舍为你做见证。求你帮助我们现在能够专心的聆听你的话语，使我们可以学习更像你的儿子，就是我们的主耶稣基督。我们这样的祷告乃是奉他的名字来祷告的，阿们。你是一个有耐心的呢，还是一个容易发怒的人呢？你可以从一个人在开车的碰到塞车的时候，拥挤的情况之下，可以反省一下，到底你是哪一类的人。有一次一个人开车到了路口，红绿灯正好转回黄色，他就很快的踩了刹车，然而在他车后的一位女士来不及刹车，就撞了他的车尾。这位女士大声的骂了一连串的脏话， 当时正好有一辆警车就在这个女士 的车后，警察就下了车，把手铐铐在这位女士手上。这位女士当然气得不得了，她就要警察说，请你解释一下你为什么这样做。警察就说，我看见你的车尾贴了一个标志 WWJD， 耶稣会怎么做，还有一个鱼的标志，但是你那个口吐脏话，让我怀疑这个车可能是 你偷来的。在前几次的信息当中，我谈到了爱、喜乐和平安的美德。上一周我讲到了非常实际和我们有贴切相关的一个主题，就是讲到节律和自制的这样子的美德。缺乏节制和自律是一个很严重的品格的缺陷，会成为我们生命的忧患，而且会破坏我们和我们最亲近人 的关系。对耶稣基督的门徒而说，缺乏节制和自律会困扰我们的良心，会破坏我们对别人的见证，也不能使我们能够 适当当的服侍我们的主。正因为节制自律在信徒的生命当中是一个这么重要的问题，所以我希望能够花一点的时间再次强调我上次信息的重点。首先，缺乏节制和自制自律的基本的原因，圣经告诉我们是由于我们每一个人里面与生俱来的一个罪性。我们做信徒的，我们必须要有明白三个很重要的字眼。第一个就是要知道，要去承认，因为从神的观点来看，我们的罪性与基督耶稣同钉十字架，罪性在神的眼光里面已经是死了的，而且神赐给我们每一个信徒有个新的性情来取代这个旧的罪性。因此我们信徒，我们需要晓得知道，我们不再受过去这个罪性的掌控了。当一个信徒他的能够凭着信心我们来承认这个 是一个事实的话，是一个已经成就了的事话，这个信徒就可以自由的去选择要顺服神来服侍神。所以我们可以看到这个我们要能够这样子的知道承认，而且能够献上自己的话，这个就是我们用 所说的用圣经化的方式去思考的意义。然而在实际的生活当中，因为缺乏节制和自律，我们每一个信徒仍然会常常会习惯性的犯罪。原因是什么呢？就是因为神没有把罪性从这个信我们每一个信徒的生命当中完全的挪去。但是罪性好像一个被锁链捆绑住的恶兽，它依然存在每一个信徒的心当中。每一次我们信徒因为不能够节制而犯罪的时候，罪性就在旁边威胁我们，恐吓我们，提醒我们，你干犯了神圣洁的律法。这样子，所以呢，就会驱使我们每一个做信徒的进入一个恶性的循环。首先我们想要更努力的去按照这个律法的要求来行事为人。当我们这样子继续不断的去做的时候，有时候我们可以得到一点的解脱，但是很快的我们又再次的失败。这种教条式的生活方式只会不断的使信徒气馁，继续活在一个失败的生命当中，不能够过一个得胜的生活。如果我们要破除这个恶性循环 的话，我们就需 要能够按着恩典的原则去生活。当我们陷入犯错和罪过的时候，圣经告诉我们说，神的恩典已经完完全全的借着耶稣基督的救赎赦免了我们。当然我们做基督徒的，我们不轻干这个救赎的工作，我们不是滥用恩典，但是我们一旦诚实的在神的面前认罪悔改的时候，你要晓得神已经洁净了我们的良心，我们的心里面就应当得到喜乐，而且用恩典的原则 继续的过我们的生活。神的恩典他也会使我们回应，而配合圣灵在我们生命里面的引导来教导我们。他会教导我们除去一个不敬虔的心，会操练我们 要除去这个属世的私欲，而在今生过一个自律公正敬虔的生活。而且因为伟大的神他我们的救主耶稣基督，他随时可以再来，随时可以显现。这个呢，就是我们基督做基督徒有福的盼望。当我们带着这个盼望的时候，我们就不会想要去继续的过一个和神的恩典不相配的生活。这样子我们才能够用心灵的新样子来跟随主，服侍主。今天我们要来看看另外一个在耶稣生命里面彰显的美德，就是忍耐。忍耐是加拉太书五章22-23节里面所谈到的圣灵的果实其中之一。圣灵的果实包括什么呢？它包括仁爱、喜乐、平安、忍耐、恩慈、良善、信实、温柔和节制。忍耐的美德就是一个过恩典生活的一个结果。忍耐和我上个礼拜谈到的节制和自律当中所提到的发怒呢，有非常密切的关系。我们每一个人生来都有自己很特别的脾气，有的人不喜欢和人冲突，但是有些人会心直口快，很容易爆发。而不管我们天然的脾气怎么样，当一个人面对压力的时候，他心里面的情绪就会变得反复无常。当这种负面的情绪不断的积压的时候，以后即使一个本来心情平静的人都可能会情绪沸腾而无法控制，最后完全瓦解。我们每一个人在生活里面遇到强烈的压力的时候，多多少少都有这种失去控制的经验。对于发怒，圣经话的回应是什么呢？就是叫我们忍耐。首先让我们 来对这个忍耐做一个定义。在圣经里面有两个字眼来描述这个忍耐的含义。第一个字呢叫做 macrothumia， macro 代表长久，而 thumia 代表怒气。你把这个 macrothumia 两个字加在一起的时候，就是说我们能够用长久的时间来消磨这个怒气。我想请问一下，你会用多长的时间来使你失去使你失去冷静呢？第二个字眼呢叫做 hypomone， hypo 是指在其之下， mone 是指的停留。你把这两个字放在一起的时候，就是说代表说能够在生活的压力之下保持那个维持一个安定的状况。在这个字眼呢，我们也常常被中文翻译成另外一个字叫做坚忍，坚持忍耐下去。也就是说我们绝不被压力所屈服。在第一个世纪里面，基督徒经过了难以言喻的迫害。使徒雅各在雅各书1:2-5里面，他就鼓励这些的信徒们，他说，我的弟兄们，你们遭遇各种试炼的时候都要看为喜乐，因为知道你们的信心经过考验，就产生什么？产生忍耐。但忍耐要怎么样？要坚持到底，使你们可以完全毫无缺乏。你们中间若有人缺少智慧，就当向那厚赐众人而且不斥责人的神祈求，他就必得着。你晓得一个温室的在温室保护当中长大的植物，如果你把它放在外面的话，它是没有办法经过这个暴风雨的摧残之下而生存的。同样，神把我们信徒放在一个困难的试炼当中，常常是有个目的，就是帮助信徒们不但向我们自己能够印证我们目前的情况，而且呢能够看我们叫我们能衡量我们是否在信仰当中有所长进。但是信徒们，我们需要智慧来帮助我们能够坚持到底，成全这个忍耐的美德。然而信徒要怎么样子才能够得到智慧呢？ 我们必须要凭着信心向神祈求。在旧约的箴言当中，箴言是一本智慧的书。在圣经里面所讲到的智慧的概念，就是 指什么呢？就是把神的话语里面学到的一些的知识，能够用实用实际的方式应用在我们日常生活里面。这个也就是我们所讲的，就是用圣经化的方式去思考。你应该记得，这个也是以勒教会在今年的主题，以圣经化的方式去思考。至于怒气，在箴言14章第29节，他提到怒气和忍耐有关的经文。这段经文 这节经文这样子说：不轻易动怒的十分聪明，这个聪明是讲到有智慧有耐心，轻易动怒的大显愚妄。你想要解决这个发怒的问题吗？你需要培养耐心。一个有忍耐的智慧人会遵循雅各他在雅各书一章19-21节所说的话，他能够借着这样子来 熬得住生活里面不可避免的压力。雅各这样说：我亲爱的弟兄们，你们要知道，人人都应该快快的听，慢慢的说，慢一点动怒，因为人的愤怒并不能成全神的义。所以你们应当摆脱一切污秽和所有的邪恶，以什么的心呢？以温柔的心，忍耐的心，接受神所栽种的道，这道能救你们的灵魂。当一个信徒能够花时间学习聆听圣灵在他心里面的声音，就像我们刚刚所唱的诗歌，要轻轻的听，来倾听听我们牧人的声音，而且我们能够去思考发怒失控那个的会造成怎么样子的一个负面的后果以后，当我们这样子想到，我们就会学习怎么样子能够慢慢的说，而且在适当的情况之下，我们要慢一点动怒，因为人的愤怒并不能成就神的义。在圣经里面有一个非常显著的一个坚忍忍耐的例子，就是大卫的故事。在撒母耳记上24章和26章里面，到26章里面记载，大卫当时受到一个以色列的第一个王扫罗很不公平的迫害。当大卫杀死了这个巨人歌利亚，而且帮助以色列人打败了非利士人之后，他受到众百姓的爱戴。但是这个嫉妒心非常强的这个扫罗王心里可不高兴，所以扫罗就说：我要除去这个大卫。而且大卫在扫罗的暴怒之下一直在躲藏，一直在逃亡。当扫罗听说大卫在一个地方叫做隐基底的时候，他就选出了3000个精兵去搜索大卫和跟随大卫的人。到了路旁的羊圈，那里有一个洞，圣经里面讲扫罗就进到洞里面去大解。那时大卫和跟随他的人正坐在洞里的深处，跟随大卫的人就说：嘿，今天是耶和华曾经答应你的，他说我要把你的仇敌交在你手里的日子，你就可以随意待他。于是大卫悄悄的就跑过去割下了扫罗外袍的一边。事后大卫心里面自责，他就跟随他的人说，他说我不能这样子的对待扫罗，因为他是耶和华所拣选的，所高立的一位，他也不让跟随他的人起来攻击扫罗。后来扫罗离开了山洞之后，大卫在扫罗的背后就呼叫说：我主我王，你为什么听信人的谗言说大卫要害你呢？他把扫罗外袍的一边给他看，来证明他无意要杀害扫罗。他求神耶和华在他们之间能够判断是非，并求耶和华为他伸冤。当扫罗听到这些话，他放声大哭，对大卫说：你以良善待我，我却以恶待你。他求耶和华以福报答大卫，而且他承认大卫日后必定要做王。这件事理当解决了扫罗对大卫不寻常的这种恨意了，对不对呢？其实不然。 在撒母耳记上26章，我们看到历史又再次的重演。当扫罗听到报告说大卫在哈基拉山中躲藏之后，他又带了3000个精兵在西佛的旷野去寻索大卫。扫罗在旷野前面的哈基拉山的路旁安营，大卫就派出探子去探查扫罗安营的地方。趁着夜里面，大卫就和他的一个同伴亚比塞到了扫罗那里。那时扫罗正躺在军营的中央睡着了，他的矛插在头旁的地上。亚比塞就对大卫说，神把你的仇敌交在你的手里了，让我用矛把他刺透在地上。大卫却对亚比塞说，不可杀死他，没有人可以伤害耶和华的受膏者拣选的人而无罪的，让耶和华自己去击打他。大卫就从扫罗的头旁拿了他的矛，拿了他的水袋，他们两个人就离开了。然后大卫跑到远远的另一处去，然后他就首先就大声的责备众军队，他说，你们为什么没有好好的保护你们的王？扫罗听见的声音以后，就听出是大卫的声音，他就大卫就对扫罗说，你为什么要带我呢？如果是耶和华激动你去来攻击我的话，但愿耶和华能够收纳你的意愿，能把我杀了吧。但是如果是人在激动你，在说闲话的话，但愿他们在耶和华面前受到咒诅。扫罗就回答，他说，我有罪了，我做了糊涂事了，我错得非常的厉害。所以大卫呢，就把扫罗的矛交给扫罗的仆人，然后他说，耶和华必按着个人的公义和信实报答他，今天耶和华把你交在我的手里，我却不愿伸手伤害耶和华的受膏者，我今天怎么样子看重你的性命，愿耶和华也同样的看重我的性命，而且救我脱离一切的患难。扫罗就回答说，愿你得福。于是扫罗也不再追杀大卫了。从这个故事里面，我们能够学到什么功课呢？首先，如果一个在一个方便的时候，并不代表这一定就是合宜的时间来做某些的事情。我们要知道神的旨意的话，应该有更高的原则，不是只是靠着方便就做的。如果我们要能够做个正确的决定，我们必须要经过圣经化的方式去思考。然后我们看到大卫知道怎么样子尊重神的选择，这样子的原则就是说，神拣选了扫罗做他所设立的王，所以大卫说，我能够分辨神的旨意，因为我晓得神的拣选，神的主权。而且就是大卫，你要晓得他是心里清楚的，因为经过这个先知撒母耳他在对他的说的话，而且能够高立他的缘故，他晓得神老早已经要拣选他，要继承扫罗为王。但是他说，现在并不是，看来是合宜的时候，却不是神的时候，他不敢僭越神的时刻。他很深深的相信说，神绝对不需要他为大卫的自己靠大卫的能力来达成他的旨意的。因此他说，我愿意耐心的等候，等候我的时间来临。你大家试想一下，如果大卫在洞穴里面或在军营当中杀死了扫罗的话，人们会怎么样去想大卫呢？大卫将会永永远远的被称为是篡夺王权的恶徒，这样子他的名誉扫地。难怪这个大卫他被称为是合神心意的人，因为他知道神的心意。那听到了这个故事以后，我们应该怎么样子运用这个功课在我们的身上呢？让我举一个非常现实的一个例子。在去年全国大选之后，许多的人由于他们认为这次的政治程序非常的不公平而感到非常的丧志。这种的情绪在1月6号 有一些人在首都抗议了以后就引起了暴动。我不论你是不是喜欢这个选举的后果，也不论你是不是认为在这个选举过程当中是否有欺诈的行为，我们作为信徒的，我们必须要记得一件事情，就是神在罗马书13章里面第一节到第二节给我们所说的话。保罗说，政府的权柄人人都应当服从，因为没有一样权柄不是从神来的，掌权的都是神设立的。你听见吗？掌权的都是神设立的，所以抗拒掌权的就是反对神所设立的，反对的人必自招刑罚。我们难道不相信神是掌控历史的主吗？他看见了在这个选举里面一切发生的事情，公正也好不公正也好，他看得一清二楚。然后我们要问，我们难道不相信神知道他在做什么吗？他当然知道。许多的人对我们自己的国家，我们看到这个国家渐渐的沦落成一个反对圣经的一个政治的系统，我们为此而叹息。但是我要提醒你，圣经已经告诉我们，牢牢早早告诉了我们，这个世界会变得越来越坏的，不会越来越好的。它已经日渐沉沦，差不多已经到了一个永劫不复的地步。我们只是盼望说，也许这位恩慈的神能够赐给这个普世另外有一次机会复兴。但就算没有的话，我们这个神的教会，他们每个人个人自己，我们都应当随时的寻求神在我们生命里面的复兴。你晓得灯光在最黑暗的时候显得最光亮，在艰难的时刻可以造就忍耐的美德，能够让我们学习做信徒的能够耐心等候主耶稣基督的再来，而且我们在同时要成为这个世界上的光，使我们可以吸引别的人来到主耶稣就是那位真光那里去。弟兄姐妹，你是不是因为脾气急躁而心里背负了一个没有安息的这个重担？你可能会问，那我怎么样子可以得到这个忍耐的美德呢？这个秘诀就是这样，我们要以耶稣基督的观点来看事物，如同并且要照着耶稣所行事的方式而行事。耶稣在马太福音11章28到30节给了我们一个伟大的邀请，他说，你们所有劳苦担重担的人呢，到我这里来吧，我必使你们得安息。我的心里柔和谦卑，你们应当负我的轭，向我学习，你们就必得到心灵的安息。我的轭是容易负的，我的担子是轻轻的。这个呼召就是要我们借着门徒训练而得到安息。我们要学习更像耶稣，忍耐就是代表一个人有柔和谦卑的心态。弟兄姐妹们，我们需要致力于个人的门徒训练，而且我们需要学习使万人做耶稣基督的门徒，这是耶稣的吩咐。我们要操练自己，要熟读，而且要了解神的话语，使我们能够用心智以圣经化的方式去思考来行事。我们要操练自己去回应，而且配合圣灵在我们生命里面的感动。我们每个人都需要神的能力来帮助我们培养这个忍耐的美德。要的最后的这一句话是我在不久以前研读哥罗西书的时候让我看到的一个真理。在哥罗西书第1章11到12节，保罗这样说，依照他就是神荣耀的大能，得着一切的能力，带着喜乐的心，凡事忍耐宽容，并且感谢父，他使你们有资格分享圣徒在光明中的基业。你是否注意到呢？保罗他说，神的大能有一个目的，就是要帮助我们每一个信徒带着喜乐的心，凡事忍耐 宽容。我们怎么可以得到忍耐呢？忍耐的美德呢？我们需要神的大能，神的大能 教导我们凡事忍耐宽容。我们讲到说，每一个人都很自然的希望说，神啊，你把你的大能赐给我们，坚固我们，然后让我们去完成一个伟大的事工，对不对？但是神有更高的目的，他希望他所赐给我们的能力可以使他的子民，就是他的儿女们，能够像他的儿子耶稣基督一样，有他的美德，就是有忍耐的美德。借着这个忍耐的美德，我们可以见证他。在任何的环境之下，弟兄姐妹，我们都能够保持平衡，耐心的等待，依靠公义的神要处理安排，来成全神自己的目的。靠着神的恩典，让我们接受耶稣基督的邀请，来做门徒，来学效耶稣，追求我们在日常生活里面能够学习聆听圣灵的声音，而且能够祈求他赐下能力，帮助我们能够过一个悦纳神而且能够忍耐的这样子的生活。感谢神赐给我们的话语，请我们大家一同低头祷告。天父，谢谢你今天给我们这个非常实际的关乎忍耐的教训，谢谢你供应我们你自己奇妙的恩典，让我们可以过一个效法主耶稣模式的这样子的生活。在这个不公平和充满重重困难的世界里面，求你帮助我们不要因这些事丧志，反而让我们可以凭着忍耐来学习信靠你，相信你的时间、你的作为和你的目的。我们求你帮助我们在别人相处的时候，就是和我们父母也好、儿女也好、朋友也好、弟兄姐妹也好，在我们交往的时候能够带着忍耐的心，帮助我们能更多的了解你的恩典，并且教导我们学校我们的主耶稣基督他的谦卑、他的忍耐，让我们可以向别人见证你实实在在有改变生命的大能。我们这样的祷告乃是奉耶稣的名祈求感恩的，阿们。弟兄姐妹，有些很简单的报告，我们有些人收到我的那个bulletin 教会的程序单，我在上面再一次提醒大家，我们有打那个打苗裔的一些的地方，我们盼望大部分的弟兄姐妹，如果不是所有的弟兄姐妹，都能够接受这苗裔之后，可以帮助我们能够尽快的开启教会的大门。第二，你们去年在2020年的奉献，非常感谢弟兄姐妹们忠心的奉献，叫教会没有缺乏。如果可能的话我们相信在这个月底之前，我们会把这个收据寄给你，作为你报税的用。请我们大家低头来领受神的祝福。保罗对提摩太说，也是神对我们每个人这样子说，特别是对我们在教会里面带领教会的人这样子说，这些事你要认真实行，专心去做，使众人看出你的长进来。你要谨慎自己，留心自己的教训，在这些的事上要有恒心，因为你这样子做不但能够救自己，也能够救那些听你的人。天父，你帮助我们能够有恒心、有忍耐的心、有坚持的心。我们也求你以大能的手保守我们众弟兄姐妹的身体、情绪和灵命里面免受伤害。我们这样的祷告是奉我们宝贵的耶稣基督的名字祷告的，阿们。弟兄姐妹，愿神深深的祝福你，保守你。
Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. His name. Tell of His salvation from day to day. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous works among all peoples. For He is great, the Lord is greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. His salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. Tell of His salvation from day to day.
Exalt every
righteousness. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness.
Good morning, everyone. So glad that you can join us in today's live stream service. The psalmist said, "My heart is steadfast, O God. My heart is steadfast. I will sing and make music. Awake my soul, awake harp and the lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth." Let us sing and make music to worship our faithful and loving Lord.
Good morning to you and greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to start worshiping this morning and we are going to sing a Chinese song first. So we'll actually sing in Chinese. So if you don't speak Chinese, you can look at the Romanized letters on the PowerPoint over there. And then we will sing it one time in an English translation. Decided to follow Jesus. Jesus himself said that the road is narrow, the way is hard that leads to salvation, and few that are that find it. Jesus completely saved us at the cross, but the road to follow him is very, very hard. Let's not fool ourselves into thinking that it's easy, and let's pray that the Lord would give us more determination to follow him.
Jesus, no turning back, no turning back.
turning back. The world behind me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back. Jesus, it is worth it all. I must obey His call. Jesus, it is worth it all. I must obey.
I have decided to follow Jesus. Have you? Have you decided? In the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, the Bible tells us that Abraham, when he was living in the Canaan land as an alien, he had opportunity to turn back, go back to his own or country, but he didn't. Why? Why not? The reason is because he is looking for the promise of God. Some of you may have made a decision to follow Jesus and no turning back many years ago. But have you followed through? Have you followed through? Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for giving us life and breath. And thank you for awakening us this morning so that we can worship you. Father, we ask for your forgiveness in that while you have been loving and faithful to us, where we have not done so. We have been apathetic in our spiritual walk with you in the past years. We regret the wasted opportunities for not placing you as our priority. We need to seek you daily. Father, but yet all of these opportunities that pass by us will never be recovered. May this, Father, be the beginning of a year where you will awaken us from the wandering souls, so that we can reevaluate our lives and resolve to put you first in all that we plan and all that we do. As the inauguration of the president is coming up, we pray, Father, for peaceful transition of the government on January 21st. As we see that the nation and our culture is rapidly turning away from you, Father, we lament and we fear the coming judgment that you will certainly unleash upon this nation, because you are a just and also sovereign God. As the prophet Habakkuk said, Lord, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds, O Lord. Renew them in our day, in our time, make them known. In wrath, remember mercy. Father, we don't know if there will yet be another chance for a worldwide revival. But even if not, may you revive your people and your church and help us to continue to conduct in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that we can become blameless and pure, living in this crooked and depraved generation, in which we shine like stars in the universe as we hold forth the word of life. This morning, Father, we thank you that our sister Carol continues to recover from COVID, and that Lin Hui, Xu Jian, and Rick are all doing well. Protect your church from this disease. And we pray that the vaccination will be efficiently administered to help relieve us from this pandemic disease. We pray, Father, for your guidance and for your wisdom so that we can know when to reopen our church doors for face-to-face worship. In the meantime, Father, we also pray that you will demonstrate your grace and love to Jaira. We pray that you will provide us an associate pastor who is after your own heart, so that we may be equipped to serve as your witnesses in our neighborhood. Right now, Father, please help us focus on listening to your word, that we may learn to be more like your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. For it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Are you a patient or a quick-tempered person? One of the ways to evaluate yourself is by looking at the way you react to the traffic when you drive car on the road. There was a story of a man who approached an intersection and a traffic light turned yellow, so he stepped on the brake. However, the woman driving behind him did not brake early enough or soon enough, and her car smashed onto his car. So she let out a string of loud cuss words. It just so happened that a police car was behind her. The policeman stepped out and put the woman in handcuffs. Now the woman was very furious, and he asked the policeman, he said, can you please explain why you're doing this to me? He said, I see on your bumper a sticker of WWJD, what would Jesus do? And also I see a sticker of a fish sign. But the way you cussed me, you cussed the driver behind before you, lead me to suspect that you probably might have stolen the car. Now, in previous messages, I had talked about the virtues of love, joy, and peace. Last week, I addressed a very relevant and practical virtue of self-control. The lack of self-control is a serious character flaw that plagues our lives, and it can damage our relationships with those who are closest to us. The followers of Jesus Christ, the lack of self-control can also bother our sensitive conscience, so much so that it can incapacitate our testimony to others, as well as our desire to serve the Lord. Because self-control is such a crucial and central issue in our life, let me take some time to reinforce the key points I made in that message. First of all, the sin nature in each of us is the root cause and the root issue of a person's lack of self-control. For believers, we must know three words. three keywords. The first word is to know and to recognize that from God's perspective, our sin nature has been crucified with Jesus Christ. It is dead. Our sin nature is dead. And God has given each believer a new nature to replace the sin nature. Thus, as believers, we are no longer under the mastery of his or her former sin nature. When the believer, secondly, by faith, regards or reckons that this is a fact, it's a done deal, the believer is free to choose to surrender to God and to serve God. So these are the three words: to know, to reckon, and to yield, to serve God. This is what I meant by thinking biblically. However, in the real life, as you all know, every believer has had the experience of sinning, habitually sinning, because of a lack of self-control. The reason is because God has not yet removed the sin nature from our lives at this point of time. While the sin nature is like a chained beast inside each of the believers, every time he or she fails practice some sinful habit, the sin nature threatens and intimidates the believer by reminding us of our violating the holy law of God. As a result, it causes the believer to be driven to a vicious cycle of three things. First of all, we try to work harder to meet the law's demands. And then perhaps by our willpower, we may have a little relief, but then eventually we're going to be sinning again. This kind of a legalistic approach only threatens or frustrates the believers into living a defeated life. We cannot have victory in our lives. Now, the solution that the Bible offers to break this evil cycle is by living the grace principle. Now, whenever we fall into sin, any sin and transgression, the Bible informs us that God's grace has already forgiven us by the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. Of course, we don't take this thing lightly. We do not abuse God's grace. But once you and I have honestly confessed the sins and we repented, our conscience is cleansed by God. And we should therefore rejoice and move on, living by the grace principle. God's grace will also enable us to walk in tune with the guidance of the Holy Spirit in us. And so it will teach us to say no to ungodliness and also to worldly passions, and also teach us to live a self-controlled, upright, and godly life in the present age. Now, in light of the imminent return and appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, our God, which is the blessed hope of the believer. A believer, therefore, we would not want to remain living a life that is unworthy of God's grace. Now, this way, we can serve God by the newness of the living living in the Spirit. Today, I would like to consider with you another virtue that exemplifies the life of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is patience. Patience is one of the values listed under the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, where it says, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, the virtue of patience is the outcome of living a life of grace. Now, there is a close connection of between patience and anger that I spoke about in the last message on self-control. Each of us is born with a unique set of temperament, and some are not so confrontational, whereas others tend to be more vocal and also explosive. But regardless of whether the natural temperament one has and how one expresses it, when we start to face pressure, the emotion inside of us can become very turbulent. When negative feelings build up, even a normally mild-mannered person can boil over uncontrollably, and therefore we can have a complete meltdown. All of us lost cool at some point in our lives when we are under strong pressure. Now, the biblical answer to anger is patience. There are two Greek words in the Bible that expresses the idea of patience. The first word is makrothumia. Macro means long, and thumia is anger. When we put them together, the word macrothumia basically means that it takes long time to burn up with anger. By the way, how long does it take you to lose control? Now, the second word is hypomone. Hypo is under, mone is to remain. Again, putting these two words together, hypomone means to remain under the pressure of life. The word actually sometimes is also translated as perseverance. In other words, it never bends to pressures. In the first century, Christian believers underwent unspeakable persecutions. The Apostle James therefore encouraged these believers in James chapter 1, verses 2 to 5. He said, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops what? Develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lack wisdom, he should ask of God, and who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. A plant that is grown in a protected greenhouse cannot survive the storm. Similarly, God often puts believers through difficult times in order to help the believer to prove whether and how much he or she has matured in faith and also in their spiritual stature. But the believer needs wisdom to work out the virtue of patience. But how does that believer gain the wisdom to do it? We ask God to do it by faith." Now, in the Old Testament, the Proverbs is a book of wisdom. The term wisdom in the Bible carries the idea of taking the knowledge from God's word, and then we put it into our daily lives in a very practical way. This is what thinking biblically is all about. To think biblically, as you might recall, is the theme for Jaira in 2021. Now, in terms of dealing with anger, one of the sayings in the connection with patience is found in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 29. That verse says, "A patient or a wise man has great understanding, but a quick-tempered person displays folly." Do you want to deal with a problem of anger? Cultivate patience. A wise person with patience will be able to endure under the unavoidable pressure of life. We will be heeding the words of James in the book of James, chapter 1, verse 19 to 21, where he says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. When the believer takes time to listen to the inner voice of the Holy Spirit, and then he starts to think through the negative consequences of losing control over anger, then that believer can speak slowly and become angry slowly, because anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Now, one of the notable examples of perseverance and patience in the scripture is the story of David, when he was unjustly persecuted by Israel's first king, Saul. And it's recorded in 1 Samuel chapter 24 and also 26. Now, you will remember that after David killed the giant Goliath, and he helped Israel defeat their enemy, perennial enemy, the Philistines, David became very popular among the people. Now, this did not bode well with the jealous king Saul. So Saul decided that he was going to eliminate David. And as a result, David became a fugitive and hid himself from Saul's violent anger. When Saul heard that David was hiding in this place called En-Gedi, he took 3,000 selected soldiers to find David. When he came to the sheepfold by the road, there was a cave. And the Bible tells us that Saul went into the cave to relieve himself. It turns out that David and his men were sitting in the recesses of the cave. David's men said to him, "Hey, this is the day about which the Lord said." He said, "I will give you your enemy in your hand, and you can do it to him whatever seems right to you." So David went, got up and quietly cut off the edge of Saul's robe. Afterwards, David's conscience bothered him. And so he restrained the man, and he said to them, "I should not have done this, such a thing to Saul, because Saul was God's chosen king. And he did not allow his men to rise up against Saul." So after Saul left the cave, David called out and said to Saul, he said, "My Lord, O king, why do you listen to those who falsely said, 'I was seeking to do you harm?'" He showed Saul the edge of his robe to prove that he had no intention of killing Saul. And he called on the Lord. He said, "Lord, will judge between us, and God, the Lord will vindicate me." When Saul heard this, he wept loudly and said to David, he said, "You have treated me well, even though I have tried to harm you." He asked that the Lord will repay David with the good, with all the goods for what he has done. He also said, "I realize now that David, you're going to be king one day." Now, this should have settled Saul's unwarranted hatred for David, right? Not so fast. In fact, in 1 Samuel chapter 26, the history repeated itself. When Saul heard that David was hiding in the on the hill of Hakilah, he took 3,000 select men again to look for David in the desert of Ziph. Saul camped by the road on the hill of Hakilah, and David sent scouts to see where Saul had camped. In the night, David approached with one of his men, Abisha, and found Saul asleep in the entrenchment with his spear stuck in the ground by his head. Abisha said to David, "God has delivered your enemy into your hands. Let me drive the spear through him with one swift jab." But David said to Abisha, "Don't kill him. No one can be against the Lord's chosen one and remain guiltless." The Lord himself will strike him down. The Lord himself would do it. So David then only took the spear and also the jug of water by Saul's head, and they got out of there. Then David crossed to the other side at some distance away, and then he called out to the army. He said, "Hey, how come you have failed to protect your king?" When Saul recognized that it was David's voice, and then David said to him, "Why are you chasing me? If the Lord has incited you against me, may he take delight in your killing me. But if man has instigated this, may they be crushed before the Lord." So Saul replied, "I have sinned. I have behaved foolishly and have made a very terrible mistake." David then gave the spear to one of Saul's men, and then he said, "The Lord rewards each man for his integrity and loyalty. Even though today the Lord delivered you into my hand, I was not willing to extend my hand against the Lord's chosen one. I valued your life today. May the Lord value my life and deliver me from all danger." And Saul replied, "May you be rewarded." So Saul left and from further pursuing David. So what's the lesson for us in this story? First of all, convenience does not always mean that it is the right time to do certain things. A lot of times we say, "Hey, it's convenient to do it, therefore we do it. It's got to be the Lord's will." Not so. There has to be a higher principle for us to know God's will. The way to make the right decision is to think biblically. Secondly, David discerned God's will. How did he discern it? Because he knows the principle of respecting God's choice. In this case, Saul was God's anointed king. While he knew that God has already chosen him to succeed Saul through what the prophet Samuel has done to him by anointing him, David would not step ahead of God's timing. He trusted that God will accomplish his purpose without his help, without David doing things on his own. And so he was willing to wait patiently for his turn to come. Imagine what people would think of David if he had killed Saul in the cave or in the camp. David would forever be called a usurper of the throne. What is that gonna do to the fame of David? David knew God's heart and God's will. No wonder David is called the man after God's own heart. So how do we apply the lessons? After the national election, many of us have been very frustrated by what they feel is an unfair political process. This sentiment led to the riot of a relatively few people in a Capitol protest on January the 6th. Now, regardless of whether a person likes the election results or not, regardless of whether there were fraudulent activities in the election process or not, as believers, we must remember God's higher principle. Because in God's word, the book of Romans, chapter 13, verses 1 and 2, Paul said, "Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established." Did you hear that? No authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. Folks, Do we not believe that is God the sovereign Lord? He's the Lord of the history. And God certainly, in his omniscience, sees everything that went on in the election. Do we not believe that God knows what he is doing? He certainly does. Many of us lament that the country is sliding further into an anti-Bible sentiment. May I remind you, the Bible has already told us that this world is going to go from bad to worse. The Bible said so. Don't expect it to turn from evil back to good. It has long been moving forward and toward the irreversible state, and the world is ready for destruction. Maybe God will yet be merciful to grant another worldwide revival. But even if not, it is always the right time for the church and for the individual believers to seek revival. Light shines best in the darkest hour, and tough times builds the virtue of patience. So brothers and sisters, be patient as we wait for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in the meantime, let us be the light of the world, that we may attract some to the true light, even the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Brothers and sisters, do you feel the burden of restlessness because of your quick temper? You might think, how do I obtain the virtue of patience? How do I get it? The secret is to look at things from Jesus' perspective and to act as he would. The great invitation of Jesus Christ in Matthew 11, verses 28-30 says this. He said, come unto me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the call to rest through discipleship, learning to be like Jesus Christ. Patience, by the way, is indicative of a person whose state of mind is characterized by gentleness and humility, just like the Lord Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, we need to commit ourselves to personal discipleship. This is Jesus' great commission. Not only do we need to disciple ourselves, but we also need to disciple others to be followers of Jesus. Discipline is means that we are to read God's word with understanding, that we may apply our minds to think biblically. Discipline also means to be constantly in tune with the movement of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We need God's power, and God will provide that power to enable us to cultivate the patience, the virtue of patience. The last statement was an aspect of truth that came to me some time ago when I was reading the book of Galatians. In chapter 1, verses 11 and 12, Paul said, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have what? Great endurance and patience, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. Did you notice this? Paul speaks of God's power serving a purpose, a higher purpose, which enables the believers to have great endurance and patience. Now, all of us probably would like to naturally desire that God, you give us a power, strengthen us with your power so that we can accomplish great works for you, right? But God has a higher purpose than that. His desire is to grant his power to help us develop and develop us who would represent him with the kind of virtues like his only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And under any and all circumstances of life, brothers and sisters, we will be patient. Learn to be patient and to persevere in a balanced state of mind. Trusting the righteous God will always take care of everything in his timing and also fulfilling his own purpose. By his grace, let us accept his invitation to learn of Christ through discipleship. Pursue to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit in our daily walk with him, and ask for his power so that we can live a life that will show forth the virtue of patience, in order that we may live lives that will be pleasing to God and that will be a great testimony to the world. Let us pray. Father, thank you for giving us this practical teaching on patience. Thank you for providing your marvelous grace for us to live a life that will be that is patterned after that of the Lord Jesus Christ. In this world that's mired in injustice and difficult circumstances, may you help us not be overwhelmed by them. Instead, that we may learn to trust in your timing, trust in your ways, and trust in your purpose in a patient way. May you help us to be patient as we interact with people, even our parents, our children, our friends, our brothers and sisters. And teach us to learn, take to others your power to change lives. And we pray and ask in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. A couple of quick announcements. The vaccination is available. Vaccines are becoming more available. I'd like to encourage all of you to consider getting vaccinated. So that this way it will help us to open the doors of the church a lot sooner. So please consider it. And secondly, thank you so much for your giving last year. God has been faithful through you to provide all of our needs. And the church will be sending you text receipt for your text purposes, hopefully by the end of January. So please look for it. And also, I'd like to continue to encourage you to join us on Thursday night prayer meeting. Please try to enter into the telephone conference telephone number and also the password. If you tried it before, it didn't work, try it again. Okay? Join us. Let us not bow for God's benediction. This is God's word from Paul to Timothy, and also it is God's word for all of us, where it says, be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them. Because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. May God protect us from harm, mentally, physically, and spiritually. And we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, may the Lord richly bless you this week as you walk patiently in God's will. Amen.
Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. His name. Tell of His salvation from day to day. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous works among all peoples. For He is great, the Lord is greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. His salvation from day to day. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. Sing to the Lord, bless His name. Tell of His salvation from day to day.
Exalt every
the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness, righteousness. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness.